Let me try that again. Welcome to Macomb Wesley United Methodist Church. There's a little switch on my microphone. I have to remember to turn it on. We gather virtually and in person to celebrate the good news that is Jesus Christ is alive. I'm Pastor Scott Grokey. Serving with me is Pastor Melly Momo. Please take a moment to sign your connection card, your registration of being and present in worship with us today. Thursday this week is National Day of Prayer. We have a breakfast at Spoon River Outreach. 7:15, Ron Pettigrew will be speaking and leading us in that prayer service. Now we turn to a 10-year blessing of our prayer shawl ministry.
Good morning. A few years before we moved to Macomb, I learned about prayer shawls and prayer shawl ministry. Some of you know that we lived over by Avon and went to the Avon United Methodist Church. And every once in a while on a Sunday morning during worship, the pastor would come down from the pulpit and take a prayer shawl and wrap it around one of the people that were in the congregation because maybe they had recovered from a surgery or an illness. Maybe they were taking care of someone at the time. Maybe they were a new grandma or a new grandpa. Then in 2011, we moved to Macomb, and we started to come to Wesley Church. At first, I spent a little bit of time trying to find my way around this building, but then I began to try to find out about the ministries of Wesley. And I realized there was no prayer shawl ministry. When I realized it, it was like God was kind of nudging me a little bit, and I was saying no. And then he would nudge a little bit more a couple of weeks later, or maybe one of the pastors would preach something that would give me a nudge, and I would say no. But finally, I talked to a couple of people in our church, and then talked to the pastors, and a few of us got together that were interested. I didn't know if there would be an interest. There was an interest. So 10 years ago in May of 2012, we had our first prayer shawl ministry meeting. And God has certainly grown it since then. And Cindy Hare is going to tell you a few of the things, how God's grown the ministry.
Good morning. I did not join in 2012 when Judy started it. I don't exactly know what year I did, but maybe God was nudging me because I did like to crochet and knit and quilt. And so I did join. And then I got nudged a little more, like she said, and I've been helping Judy the past probably 4 or 5 years. And I want to say that this woman is remarkable. We all know that, and I want to thank her for starting this ministry here at Wesley Church. I think we served a lot of people, so I want to thank her. On Friday, we placed all these prayer shawls up here on the altar, and I counted them, and we had 54. We had 4 go out this morning, which was a good thing. When I looked at my notes, the last time we had this blessing of the prayer shawls was in 2019, and we had 54 then. So we didn't stop during the past couple of years. We're still moving on with everything. The colorful shawls that are placed here this morning have been knitted and crocheted and quilted, and you're more than welcome to come up after the service and look at them. They're all very unique, and they're all made with prayers as we make them. They've been given to those individuals who are sick, grieving, caregivers, and those trying to cope with difficult life circumstances. They're also given to individuals celebrating the birth of a new baby and high school graduates. We remained active, just like a lot of us in this church, the past 2 years during the pandemic. And we've been able to serve individuals not only in the Macomb area, but throughout the United States and abroad. Many stay in Macomb, but many have been packed in suitcases, accompanying our members on their mission trips, going to destinations such as Costa Rica, Mexico, Cuba, and all over the United States. We want to thank the individuals who have led mission trips the past 10 years, Scott Edwards, Byron Bachman, Jim Olson, and Bertha and Rodney Fink. We're sure there will be room to take a few more on this year's mission trip to Granite City, and I did talk to Jim, and they are going to take more mission or more Shaws down to the mission trip to Granite City. We're going to share with you our different agencies and organizations that we've served through our mission. We provide prayer shawls to Western Illinois Regional Council's victim services for them to distribute to their clients with the hope that the shawls will comfort them as they go through the recovery process. WIRC also sponsored Project Santa, and this past year we provided 26 knitted hats for local area children. Operation Gratitude is an organization based in California that sends care packages to veterans, wounded heroes, and their caregivers, and to active U.S. service members deployed overseas and their families waiting at home. For the past 6 years, we participated in their Scars for Troops program, providing crocheted and knitted winter scarves. This past year, we also participated in their Clear Your Stash Challenge, and knitted and crocheted 24 winter hats for them to include in their special care packages. This past year, we started providing baby blankets, hats, and booties to the Birthright Agency located in Macomb that provides needed services to pregnant women. For the past 6 years, we've provided winter scarves to local residents so they can keep warm during our cold winter months. We distribute scarves to the Macomb Public Library and the WIU Food Pantry housed in Horbin Hall. We want to thank Dennis Donowski and the WIU for their continued support in this endeavor. And also, we don't want to forget our residents at the Wesley Village Healthcare Center. In December, we provide several prayer shawls for them to gift to their residents at their annual Christmas party. And I've been at those Christmas parties when my mom was a resident there, and it's really touching to see them open the gifts. You know, they're just like little kids because they have a present to open, and it really makes your heart full to see that. In March, we gave 16 prayer shawls to the Wesley Foundation. Many of them are international students who gather for fellowship at the foundation. We felt that they would appreciate receiving the shawls, reminding them that they are now part of our family here at Wesley Church while they attend Western. We provide angel blankets and rainbow blankets to MDH's Dolores K. Switzer's Women's Center for them to distribute to new mothers. Now, back in April of 2020, when our whole world kind of went topsy-turvy with the pandemic, many of you remember that we could not get masks. You know, they weren't available quite yet in the stores. And so our ministry, along with the Health and Wellness Committee, decided to provide cloth face masks to the Macomb community. We had them placed out in the atrium where they could come in, because the church was locked at that time, I believe. And so we distributed 314 masks to local area residents. We believe that God knows who will receive each shawl, and it is with his love that it is given. We would like to thank Jim Olson for putting together the slide presentation that we had out in the atrium. It's also on the church's website, too, and there's a narrative there about our 10th anniversary and what we do in our ministry. We want to thank Tammy Powers also for including our ministry announcements in the newsletter and bulletins. And Pastor Scott, would you please lead us in the blessing of the prayer shawls?
Please join with me in this blessing of the prayer shawls you'll see on the screen. May God's grace be upon these shawls, warming, comforting, enfolding, and embracing. May they be a safe haven, a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing good times as well as difficult ones. May each one who receives a shawl be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced with peace, and wrapped in love. Amen. Thank you.
God is good
all the time.
Please stand for our call to worship, if you are able. God has made this day. Let us rejoice and be glad. In this season of resurrection, we offer prayer. God, we confess our need to remain in the world, the bread, and the cup. Teach that things are possible in you. Empower us to nurture those around us and find new death in a gracious love. Amen.
Raise your hand if you like to get hugs. Do you like to get hugs? You like to get hugs? Okay, you can put your hand down. Raise your hand if you like to give hugs. Good. You know, we haven't been able to give many hugs in the last couple of years, have we? We've kind of been limited. But that's kind of getting over with, and we're giving more hugs now, aren't we? Not to everybody. Oh, bless your heart. Well, this morning we've talked about prayer shawls, and that's what's hanging all around here. They're just hanging around, and they're called prayer shawls. This is a prayer shawl. This is my prayer shawl. Every one of these shawls have been made by somebody. They haven't been made in a factory. They've been made by a person. A person, a very special person, made this one for me. When I put my prayer shawl on, sometimes I put it on when I feel sad. Sometimes I put it on when I feel happy. Sometimes I put it on when I don't feel very good. Sometimes I pull it around me real tight, and it feels like a hug, just like God's hugging me, because I know that a lot of people prayed over this prayer shawl, and I can feel that. When I look up at the prayer shawls here, I think of hugs. I think every one of them are hugs for whoever's going to get it. And somebody's going to get these prayer shawls. Going to be different people get each prayer shawl someday, sometime, when they need it. And it's going to be like a hug from Jesus. The Bible tells us Jesus loves us, each one of us, doesn't it? He loves us. And even though maybe we don't feel like he's hugging us, he really kind of is. And I want you to remember that, okay? Okay, Jesus loves you. You are special. And when you give a hug to somebody, that's special. And it makes them feel special. Can you pray with me? Jesus, thank you, thank you, thank you for the children. Thank you that you're with us all the time, that you don't ever leave us, and you say you will never leave us. Help us get through this week, Father. Whether we go to school, whether we go to daycare, whether we're home with mom and dad, whatever. Bless each of these children, Lord. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, I want to give you something before you go. It's a little butterfly. It's not a real one. It's a paper one. It's colored on one side, and the other side says, hug. So this week, if there's somebody you want to give a hug to, and you just don't quite want to hug them, give them this butterfly. Tell them, this is my hug to you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. This is the time for us to pray, and I have a prayer request here. We praise the Lord for the birth of Charlie Grant, born to Eric and Ciara Isnogo. His family are celebrating and appreciate continued prayer for his progress 7 weeks early. And we also pray for the family of Jennifer Neeson. Now let us go to the throne of God in prayer. God of glory, God of power, God of might, we thank you, Father, for allowing us to come this hour to worship you. Lord, I pray that your spirit will move upon each one of us and minister to us according to the needs. Lord, I pray that your spirit will move to those who are worshiping with us wherever they are. Lord, I ask that you bless them as well. I ask that you accept this act of worship and let you reign in our lives. Lord, we pray for those who are not feeling well, asking for your grace of healing to be upon them and celebrating with those who are celebrating healing this morning. We also pray for those who have lost loved ones, asking that you comfort them and strengthen them in this walk. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for your love, for your words you have made available for us to help us in our walk with you. We give you praise for the many blessings, and we give you thanks for the promises you have given us to be always with us. Lord, we thank you as we remember our country, lifting our country in your hand and asking that you be with the leaders. Inspire them with your wisdom, Lord, so that they are able to lead this country according to your will. Lord, I rebuke all powers of darkness against us in the name of Jesus. Also pray for United Methodist Church. We ask that your spirit will be upon us, be upon the leaders. Help us to be in ministry. Help us to do your will, not our will, Lord. Thy will be done. Lord, I thank you so much for your faithfulness and your grace, and always ready to hear us as we pray together the way your Son, Jesus Christ, continue to teach us. Our Father, who art in heaven, our Lord be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we'll pray for the offering. Lord, I thank you for this act of giving. I ask that you bless what we are about to give in the name of Jesus and multiply it for your work, Lord. Bless the source of providence. Lord, I pray that your spirit will continue moving upon us into giving. In the name of Jesus Christ, I give you praise and glory. Amen. Please be seated. Our Old Testament reading is coming to us from Exodus chapter 3, verse 1 to 6. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, come no closer, remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God.
Thank you.
you'd like to follow as I read, turn in the Gospel of John to chapter 21. After these things, Jesus showed up himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. He showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, have you no fish?" They answered, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard it, that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you've caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. Though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time, he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to Peter, "Follow me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The word that comes to life among us. Nourish us, God, in this word. Help us to understand, to embrace what we find here. Nourish us in Jesus, in his name. Amen. Earth's crammed with heaven, and every common bush afire with God. But only he who sees takes off his shoes. The rest sit around and pluck blackberries. Elizabeth Browning is referring to Moses, who encountered God in a flaming bush. She reminds us that God is everywhere. We just need to be sensitive to the holy ground where we stand. Easter season has been a reminder that we stand on holy ground. Easter's not simply a day on a March or April calendar. It is a moving season. Pastor Melly and I have reminded you every Sunday is a mini Easter. Resurrection is not a season, it's an attitude, a transformed lifestyle. In John's gospel, the professionals had been fishing all night. The nets were empty. Through the morning mist, a stranger calls from the shore. Children, have you caught anything? Cast your nets on the right side. The disciples had been grieving their master's death. They were bewildered, confused, and disoriented even after his resurrection appearance. Their mission was eroded by his loss. So they retreated to their boats and fishing nets that they knew so well. Do you ever feel that way when you're overwhelmed by drama, that you just need some time and space to sort things out, to renew? And it's tempting to return to the same old things you've always done the same old way. When the disciples cast their nets on the other side of the boat, they discover, like Dorothy and Oz, they're not in Kansas anymore. They don't need to fish on the same old side of the boat. The miracle occurs, the universe has shifted, and the disciples are hooked. The hook, Jesus walks among us so anything is possible. Back in 2010, it happened on the Spoon River, not far from here. Let's take a look at a fishing moment for some boys and their fathers as the silver carp nervously respond to the sound of a motorboat. By the way, this video gives new meaning to the lyrics, "Summertime and the living is easy, fish are jumping, and the cotton is high." Your net on the other side of the boat, which is another way of saying, try it this way. In the scriptures, miracles happen because Jesus is still walking in our midst. So if the solutions fail to arrive for you and your problems, and you reach the end of your resources, God offers a third alternative. Jesus walks among us so all things are possible. The Creator who fills the sky with birds, who places cattle on 1,000 hills, who fills the sea with schools of fish, is here, the living Lord. Anything is possible. That's the hook in the story. The line is connecting to our responsibilities. Look at verse 15, where the disciples are fed by Jesus. After breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He asks Peter because Peter had fearfully denied to the authorities that he even knew Jesus. Fast forward to this moment when the resurrected Jesus stands face to face with him. Phyllis Provost Sass explains their encounter this way. Peter waited for Jesus to yell at him, to throw the book, to cry out, "Where were you when I needed you?" But Jesus' response is softly repeated 3 times, "Simon Peter, do you love me? Take care of my sheep, feed my lambs, shepherd my little sheep." The hook, the line, the sinker. The hook, Jesus is present so all things are possible. The line, our responsibility to nurture disciples in God's love. At Wesley Church, our mission is to help people cultivate a growing relationship with God through Jesus. Let's try that together. To help people cultivate a growing relationship with God through Jesus. Whether or not you can quote that, you get it. You understand at Wesley Church what it is to nurture others in the faith. There are any number of remarkable expressions that came out of this ministry for nurturing others in the faith. I'm going to name a few of them. Shawls are another one of these nurturing ministries. How about these? Number one, the Fellheimer Trust. It came as a gift from Jay Wallace and Lulu Fellmeyer that provides educational scholarships, grants to community agencies, outreach ministries, and churches throughout the United States and around the world. Number two, Wesley Village. Wesley Village was motivated by leaders of this church in 1975 to develop a campus for independent living, licensed care, and intermediate nursing for senior adults. Some of you, many of your friends, family members have found their senior years enriched in this faith community of Wesley Village. Many of you have also served on the Wesley Village board. Thank you for your compassionate use of time and energy. Number three, the Wesley Christian Child Development Center. We affectionately call it Wesley Daycare. Many of you, your children, your grandchildren, were nurtured in this friendly, family, faith environment during the magic years of childhood. Thank you, Director Carol Pasley, previous directors and daycare board members for the long hours, devoted leadership, stabilizing actions. The pandemic could have shut us down permanently more than once, but you're resilient. And Wesley Daycare thrives again. God is good all the time. Fellheimer Trust, Wesley Village, Wesley Daycare, and number four, WIU Wesley Foundation, 1325 West University Drive. It began in this church in 1963. Before it was established as a university campus ministry to provide a Christian environment for students of Western Illinois University. Now, next month, Reverend Janice Serfica will complete her ministry with the foundation. We are grateful for her brief, passionate, devoted leadership. A new opportunity is before us. The Foundation Board has requested this church to partner in ministry with these students. Most of them are young adults where relationships are developing and career paths are forming, right? We hope. All of that. This week, our church council has unanimously determined it will assist to reestablish a vital support for this ministry to students of Western Illinois University. Four remarkable expressions of your nurturing outreach to others. You get this. You understand. Our line is to be responsible to serve others, to nurture others in the faith. My own nurturing skills go back to fourth grade, I think. That's when I brought Gyroscope home. He was a quarter-pound newborn, had long, soft brown hair, a bit of odor. Mom said, keep him in a cage on the back porch. This guinea pig became part of our family. But I was responsible to care for him, nurture, supply his nutrition, keep him in a relatively clean environment, protected environment. I thought I was doing that well. Until that cold, fateful September night when the frost came and we were away. That protected environment failed him. We returned home. His systems were in shock. The next morning, he died in my arms. Now, Gyroscope was not your typical pet, but even a guinea pig has needs. And his life gave this fourth grader important lessons in providing nurturing love for another living thing. In today's Gospels, found the hook, the line, and the sinker. The hook, Jesus is present so all things are possible. The line, he connects us to our responsibility to nurture others in God's love. The sinker, he calls us to new depths of discipleship. 23 times in the four Gospels, Jesus said, follow me, follow me, follow me. Are you? Where are you headed? Where are you going? I remember reading about Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes. He was about 80 years of age. He got on a train at Union Station in Washington, D.C. The porter came by for his ticket. He couldn't find it. Searched through all his pockets and his briefcase. Finally, the porter came back and said, Mr. Holmes, we know you. When you get home, you'll find your ticket. Just mail it back. Justice Holmes said, you don't see the problem. The problem is not, where is my ticket? The problem is, where am I going? Where am I going? Jesus says, where you're going is following me. We'll figure it out. I will lead you. Follow me. In the sacrament, we find the line, the hook, line, and sinker. The sinker to new depths of discipleship. To the living Christ who says, follow me. It begins as Pastor Melly comes now to lead us in the sacrament of Holy Communion.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, take it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and juice, make them before us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry for all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heaven banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
I remind you, you do not need to be a member of this church. If your desire is to follow Jesus Christ, you're welcome to the table. We are going to ask our choir to commune first, and the ushers will then lead you forward to the kneeling rail. Christ has come for us. from this place with the call of Jesus in your ears, in your mind, disturbing you in the night until you get it. Follow me. He said, follow me in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.